You're jumping into CKCU programming through our audio archive, supported by you, the listener.
Welcome to my world. Welcome to my world.
Welcome to my world.
Welcome to my world. The voice that enables.
It's not just what you're born with, it's what you choose to bear. It's not how large your share is, it's how much you can share. It's not the fights you dream of, it's those you've really fought. It's not just what you're given, but what you do with what you've got. It's not just what you're born with, it's what you choose to bear. It's not how large your share is, it's how much you can share. It's not the fights you dream of, it's those you've really fought. It's not just what you're given, but what you do with what you got.
Hi, this is Shelley Ann Morris. You are listening to Welcome to My World on CKCU FM 93.1. Today, we have some really interesting people from different organizations. We have Rob Minot from Blind Beginnings, and we have Ryan Fleury from Canadian Assistive Technologies. Both of them are also on a podcast called AT Banter, which we'll talk about in a little while. Hi to you both. Thank you for taking time to be on Welcome to My World.
Thanks for the invitation. Much appreciated.
Thanks so much for having us.
You are both in BC. Whereabouts are you in BC?
I'm in Coquitlam.
I'm in New Westminster, but essentially we're both in Vancouver. For anybody who doesn't live in the Lower Mainland, it's all Vancouver.
Ryan, tell us about Canadian Assistive Technologies.
Sure. Canadian Assistive Technologies is owned and operated by Steve Barclay, who people may know from a previous assistive technology company called Aroga. Steve's been in the industry almost 30 years now, doing blindness low vision sales, support, training, service, you name it. He's done the whole gamut. He brought me on in 2017, just after he started the company, to do his blindness tech support and sales as well. So I've been working with him for 3 years now, doing support on blindness products, software, hardware, you name it.
And there's a lot out there. How did you become involved with Canadian Assistive Technology and the whole assistive technology field?
I lost my sight back in 1995 in a car accident, and I was living in the interior of BC at that time. And so I had been put in touch with the CNIB there and got to know a couple of the other blind and partially sighted citizens of the area and got my orientation mobility and some Braille instruction. And I realized that there really wasn't a lot for me in the interior, and I was going to have to move to the Lower Mainland, go back to school, get retrained, because I'd been working in forestry up until I lost my sight. And so when I moved down to the Lower Mainland, I went to BCIT and took a call center training program because I thought, well, you know, I'm blind, I'm going to have to use a computer and a phone and a screen reader like JAWS. And so that's what I did. I took that course and started looking for work. And it just so happened that before that all happened in 1997, I got my first computer and screen reader through Aroga Technologies, and that's how I'd met Steve Barclay. And so when I moved to Lower Mainland here and started looking for work, Aroga was looking for someone to do tech support, and they brought me on. And I've been working with Steve ever since the year 2000 now. He always says the reason he hired me was to eliminate his worst tech support client, being me. So it was just easier to hire me.
You do a lot of the tech support. When people call, they have difficulty with their products, need some help.
Yeah, they can't get their screen reader to talk, or they can't get their Braille display connected to their screen reader. You name it, the scanning and reading software. There's so much out there now.
In that time, you must have seen a lot of developments of technology. What are some of the things that have really stood out to you in the last number of years that you've been in the field?
I think what has really been revolutionary in the blindness and partially sighted arena are wearables. You know, we have products like the Sunu Band now, which is very similar to a smartwatch for the blind that gives you haptic feedback as you draw nearer or further away from an obstacle. And it has other features built in, like a compass, and there's an app for your phone. And so wearables is definitely one. The OrCam is another one where you can wear this camera mounted onto a pair of glasses, point your finger at something, and it'll do recognition and tell you what that item is or what that text says. So I think wearables has really been the revolution, and now we're seeing more and more about LiDAR and indoor navigation, which is pretty exciting.
Can you explain what LiDAR is?
LiDAR is a system of basically a camera that shoots out lasers within a building space. So it'll measure out the distance between walls, ceiling. It'll detect any obstacles like fountains or benches, tables, and basically creates a three-dimensional map that can then get entered into a system. And then basically with an app on your smartphone for iOS or Android, you can actually walk into that building and it'll say, walk to your right, men's bathroom, 30 feet on your left. And as you're walking, it'll tell you obstacle, you know, bench on your right, washroom, 10 feet, 5 feet, 2 feet. There's so much flexibility in a system like that, whereas we've never had access to the indoor space before. You know, we've had GPS for outdoors for decades, but the indoor space is really a wild frontier still. So I think that's pretty exciting. Rob works for a nonprofit here in BC called Blind Beginnings. Maybe you want to touch on what they do.
Please do.
It's an organization that supports and provides programming for children and youth who are blind or partially sighted. It was created by a lady named Sean Marcellet here in Vancouver about 12 years ago. At the time, she was working at the CNIB, but she noticed that there was a real gap in the amount of programs that were provided specifically for 6-year-old to 19-year-olds. And so she decided that she was going to spin off and start this organization. She's really done an amazing job in building it in the last 13 years. It has come a long way. There are these real service gaps. It's hard to provide services for everybody who might need it, especially in those formative years. That's really what I think drew her to start up this particular organization. Those years when you're blind and partially sighted, that's where you build all your outlook on life and all your habits. So those are really crucial times to have that support and to have programming and services that we provide. I've been involved in the assistive technology field for almost 16 years, and that's where Ryan and I met. I just fell into it. I was a sort of a fledgling graphic and web designer, and I happened across this company that at the time needed some graphic and web design services done. I knew nothing about assistive technology. I'd never worked in the disability community. I didn't even know anybody who was blind or visually impaired. So it was only a few years in that I really gained a passion for this. It was a really good fit. I was looking for a new gig, and they happened to be hiring. And I thought, you know, this is a unique opportunity for me, because previous to that, I had been sort of more in the marketing side of things and in the retail side of things, and which was rewarding enough. But this was a real chance for me to really sort of get my feet wet in the advocacy side of it. And I've been doing it for now for about a year, and I just love it.
Brian, do you have a go-to technology, something you just can't do without now?
My iPhone doesn't leave my pocket. There's so much accessibility built into the iPhone. I use apps like Be My Eyes, Ira from time to time, which are services that you can call a live agent, and they can see through your phone camera and describe what it is that you're looking at, pointing at, what something might be. If my computer doesn't come up and isn't talking to me, I can use them. They can tell me what's on my screen and help me troubleshoot that. So my iPhone is my go-to.
I don't know how we manage without them.
Well, I remember the old Nokia phones where we used to have to install a program like Talks or Mobile Speak. You could send a text message, you could look through your contacts or your calendar, but once the iPhone came out and had voiceover built in, it just really changed everything.
That's come up for a lot of us in the blind, low vision community with regard to the pandemic, being able to have access to information and services from your phone that are accessible to us has really changed things. Tell us about the AT Banter podcast.
The AT Banter podcast, that was something that Ryan and I and the company owner, Steve Barkley, we were sort of sitting around a lunchroom table one day and thought, you know, we all listen to podcasts. We all enjoy podcasts. We're like, why don't we start a podcast? We sort of have stuff to say about assistive technology. We could certainly talk about that. So we started up this little thing we called AT Banter Podcast. And surprisingly, we've been doing it for almost 5 years now.
We start our sixth year in May.
Oh my gosh. See, I've even lost track. I don't even know how long we've been doing it.
It's interesting because, you know, at first when we decided to launch the podcast, we thought AT, Assistive Technology Banter, what a great name. And as the show has grown over the years, we've realized that there's more to the disability arena than assistive technology. And in the last couple of years, probably 3 years, I guess, we've really been having a mix of guest interviews. Still some assistive technology, interviews with manufacturers, spotlights on specific products. But I think what really gets us going is the human interest stories. The people that maybe are receiving their first guide dog, or maybe somebody who has suffered a brain injury and has a piece of tech that has given them their independence back. I think that's why we keep doing this show week after week after week, is there's no shortage of people to talk to. And everybody has a story to tell. So yeah, if you haven't checked it out, atbanter.com.
I noticed that there was a real mix. You were talking to people that have non-visible disabilities or people with mental health challenges. I think there's going to be an episode coming up with Louise Gillis, who is the board president of CCB.
Yeah, that one was released last week.
As you say, there's no shortage of people and stories. That's what I find with this show as well.
Yeah, it really surprised us early on. You know, we sort of realized early on that there were other podcasts that talked specifically about the technical side of assistive technology, and they did it much better than us. They were much more knowledgeable, much more well-spoken in a lot of ways. And we thought, why compete with that? Why become just another technology podcast when we can branch out and start talking to the people who use assistive technology as opposed to just the assistive technology? And so we really branched out and we started to find that for ourselves, those were the episodes that really engaged us and really got us excited. And I think got our audience more excited and got them more engaged. So we just started shifting our focus away from AT specifically, which is too bad because by then, of course, we had already branded the podcast, the AT Banter Podcast. So I think that we all wish that we could kind of rebrand at this point and call it something other than that. But it is a real testament to the community and to how much the show means to us that we have maintained it for this long. Because, and I'll just speak for myself, not necessarily Ryan, but I don't know anything that's lasted in my life for 5 years. I don't have any hobbies or anything that I've done for 5 years. So it does really speak to the community because it's an absolute delight talking to a lot of the people that we talk to. I mean, just this week we recorded an episode where we were talking to a local young lady who's, I think she's 21. She had a brain tumor. So she's dealing with a brain injury, but she wrote her first book. And it was just an absolute delight talking to her and hearing her story and what the message of the book was. And it's such a great message. It's weeks like that, for me anyways, that really make the show worth it and make it worth all the work that we do put into it.
And for me, it's educational. We have some shows coming up where we're going to be speaking to someone from Autism Canada. I'm totally blind and I know nothing about autism. I've heard of a spectrum, but I have no idea what that is or what that means. So a lot of these shows are very educational and informative and we get a lot out of them.
I can say the same thing about Welcome to My World. We've learned so much from the people that we've had on the show and it's just been a great learning experience all around.
You know what? We'll have to have you on the show.
Shelley's low vision and a triathlete. I think there's a story there.
Yeah.
You have a couple of Canadian assistive technology get-togethers on Zoom. Tell us about that. I know the pub is pretty popular.
We're still waiting for you to show up, Shelley. Tuesday mornings at 10 a.m. Pacific, we open up what we call the anti-gloom Zoom room, where people from the community can jump in and socialize. It's a casual conversation. A lot of people are talking about Farkle, which is a dice game app for your smartphone, iOS or Android. But we talk tech. We talk all sorts of topics. So it's, again, just a casual conversation. Anyone's welcome to jump in that. It usually runs for about an hour and a half. And then Thursday nights, we have what we call the virtual pub night. That starts at 5 p.m. Pacific, and we've done an all-nighter. So we've gone till 6 in the morning the next day. It's a lot of fun. We'll play music sometimes. Other nights, there's trivia. And again, it's just a casual conversation where we're just getting together chatting. You know, this is something that Rob and I were talking about actually earlier today, is that, you know, most of us are going to pick up our groceries and coming home. We're not commuting to work, and we're not experiencing the world like we used to before the pandemic. And so I think some of us, I know myself, are losing some of that casual conversation. You know, how was your day? Have you seen any movies lately? Because we're not seeing people. We're not interacting like we used to. This doesn't replace that by no means, but it's an alternative for people to just gather together and chat, because I know that we have some clients that are living alone and they may not have family. So the more the merrier.
Zoom has opened that and brought different communities together. Geography is not a problem.
That's definitely one thing I've noticed, is that being in the assistive technology field for 20, 21 years now that I have been, I've met people from the East Coast that I've never, ever met before using Zoom and our virtual pub nights or our anti-gloom Zoom room. So one of the benefits of the pandemic is I think it's brought the community much closer together. A lot of us have made new friends and stay in touch throughout the week as well. It's not just a once a week, twice a week event. So there's an opportunity to check in with people and just ask how they're doing.
Who knows, maybe in the future when we are able to meet in person, maybe we'll have a hybrid model where we'll have some people on Zoom and some people in an actual meeting room. Who knows?
Yeah,
I definitely think there's going to be a conversation following the pandemic, because I have a feeling that there's going to be a lot of occurrences of PTSD. We're so used to now washing our hands, letting things sit for a couple days before you open them or engage with them. There's just so many precautions we've been taking. It's going to be hard to unlearn some of that behavior.
Yeah, going out without a mask is going to feel very strange for a while.
Right.
Yeah.
I haven't had a cold for a year, so I'm actually considering just keeping going what I'm doing even after the pandemic, because this is great.
Masks might be more commonplace than they were before the pandemic.
Who would have thought you could walk into a bank wearing a mask, right? I was saying to somebody the other day, nobody I know has been hit with the flu this year. And my theory is that COVID has eaten the flu virus.
Ryan, you are a singer-songwriter as well. And you have a song that is particularly apropos, especially from what we were just talking about and for the times we're living in now. It's called The Social Distancing Blues.
That song is bizarre to me, because I was just kind of sitting around here, what they call the guitar dungeon, which is my home theater slash studio slash office. And going through the pandemic, like we all are, I thought there has to be something I can do, sing, write, to just kind of bring some levity to the situation. So I grabbed one of my guitars and I started coming up with a bit of a tune. And then I reached out to Steve Barkley as well and said, you know, I'm having some trouble coming up with some lyrics, so can you throw me some? So he contributed probably about half the lyrics to that song. And then I came up with the rest. And then also my collaborator, Mike Charcello, who you may be aware of in Montreal, is blind and an excellent guitar player, as well as piano, organ, you name it, he plays it. So he's collaborated with me on a bunch of my songs, and he did the guitar parts and the keyboard parts and made it kind of bluesy. So that's where Social Distancing Blues came from.
Mm-hmm. I do. Come on, people, it's not hard to do. Hey, you, why can't you follow the rule? We've got the COVID-19, social distancing blues. Yeah, you with the mask hanging under your nose. No, that's not how wearing one of those goes. Hey, you, I think you're a little confused. Pull it up over your nose and help slow the social distancing blues. The year 2020 taught us how to stay alive with face shields, masks, and hands to hand sanitize. But some people say they still want more proof. The experts say these tools should help slow the social distancing blues.
Let's go, Mike.
Hey there, Karen, why are you yelling at the clerk? You know you're just looking like some kind of jerk. Hey you, what are we supposed to do? Why don't you step out of the line and help slow the social distancing blues? Well, they tell us to stay at least 6 feet apart, but you know that some of us are blind and that's kind of hard. Hey you, what are we supposed to do? We just want to do our part to help slow the social distancing blues. The year 2020 taught us how to stay alive with face shields, masks, and hands to hand sanitize. But some people say they still need more proof. The experts say these tools will help slow the social distancing blues. Oh, the social distancing blues. We just want to do our part to help slow the social distancing blues.
You are listening to CKCU 93.1 FM in Ottawa.
Today on Welcome to My World, we have Ryan Flory from Canadian Assistive Technologies, and we also have Rob Minot from Blind Beginnings. We just heard Ryan's song, Social Distancing Blues. Ryan, tell us where we can find your music.
Sure. If you're interested in hearing more of my music, you can visit whitecanerecords.com.
Easy enough. Rob, earlier we were talking about the effects of the pandemic, and I'm just wondering, through your work with Blind Beginnings, have you seen how this whole thing has influenced or had an impact on young people, blind, visually impaired youth?
Yeah, definitely. The organization was built on programming that was really built on face-to-face programming. They'd have workshops where the youth would gather and they would learn everything from daily living skills to how to shop independently, all kinds of different programming, but they were all very much grounded in face-to-face. So the organization was really faced immediately with this quandary of what are we going to do? How are we going to pivot and provide this service to an online-only situation? And so credit to them, they managed to do it and are still doing it a year into the pandemic almost. It's a matter of shifting the emphasis. And right now, those types of programs are more important than ever because everybody's feeling new stresses. Even doing tasks, when you're blind or visually impaired, even just the task of going to the grocery store has a new set of stress that you didn't have before. So having support systems and having these community-based systems in place is just so important. They definitely did have to really rack their brains and move quickly to shift their programming to this new online world that we're all living in. And in a way, there's a silver lining to it. Because they are doing that, they're able to service people in more remote areas. And I'm sure that this is the case with all kinds of different charities and different advocacy groups. There are benefits to having online programming, and that's that you can service people in the rural areas as opposed to just people in the urban areas. So in ways they've been able to connect with youth in remote areas of the province that they would never have been able to even connect with normally.
You mentioned about different stresses that we didn't have to deal with before. That's a very interesting topic, what it is to be blind in a pandemic world.
Well, I know for me, I'm very fortunate. I have a wife who has sight. And so she orders our groceries online. We hop in the car. We do curbside pickup. They load the car. We come home. We unload. So that's really as much public interaction or engagement that we're having. Yeah. I don't have to worry about which direction the arrows are pointing in the grocery store, or am I 6 feet apart from somebody? I can't imagine if I was living alone, living independently, and having to do all this by myself. At least now we have services that you can have groceries delivered to you. But even workplace environments, I don't know how people are making the accommodations.
Yeah, there are all kinds of different issues if you really think about it. When you're blind, you can't see if you are 6 feet apart from somebody. You can't even see if that other person is wearing a mask, or all these things that sighted people might take for granted about being able to navigate the world and navigating your space in a safe way, that as somebody who's blind, you can't operate like that. So it is very stressful. And we see that all the time from youth, especially our teenage program participants. You know, teenagers, they want to be out in the world. They miss their friends. They want to go out for walks. And if every time you walk out that door, you don't know what people are doing around you, that's a real problem. And it's not fair to just say, well, there is stuff like curbside pickup, or you can have your groceries delivered, because at some level, you're a prisoner in your own space if you can't ever feel safe going outside.
I see people on Twitter mentioning it from time to time, social media, other sources, time to time, but I don't really hear the advocacy groups talking about it, or if they are, it's not very loudly.
The guys always sort of tease me on the podcast because I'm kind of the optimist of the three of us. But I do like to think that the pandemic has some silver linings. And I think it really has created conversations around accessibility that I don't think were happening pre-pandemic in the physical space, but also in the online space. If the pandemic has done anything, it's really shone a light on the importance of digital accessibility, because so many essential services have had to shift to online. And when those services aren't accessible, that creates a real problem. So I feel like more people are paying attention to that these days.
Like Rob said, I think the pandemic has definitely opened people's eyes to gaps in the systems digitally and the built environment. And hopefully we're gonna see more advances going forward.
Ryan, you recorded a song. And not only did you record a song, you made it accessible. Tell us about the song and how that happened. We are going to play the song.
The song is called Make a Difference. I started writing this song in 2019 and probably had most of it done by the end of 2019. And then I thought, okay, should I release this? It's not quite done. I wasn't quite happy with it. And then, of course, 2020, the pandemic hit. And I thought, you know, I've got this song. If I change a few of the lyrics here and there, it would speak to the situation, the events that we're currently going through. And so I did that. I rewrote some of the lyrics. I sent it over to my buddy, Mike Churchello, again. He put together the drum track, the electric guitar, piano, mixed it all, sent it back to me. That was, I guess, April or May when that song was finally done. And so I just kind of sat on it for a while. And then September or October, the Alliance for the Equality of Blind Canadians was putting on a virtual concert over Zoom, I think it was. And they asked musicians and other artists from the community to submit works. And I thought, well, you know, I've got this song. The audience is probably mostly going to be blind and partially sighted. It'd be really cool if I could turn this into an audio described music video. part of my thinking behind that was on our podcast, we've had Diane Johnson, who is the studio head at Descriptive Video Works, on our show a couple times. And we've developed a bit of a relationship with her. And I thought I could always reach out to her and see if this is something they're willing to do. But before I did that, I approached Rob and I said, hey, we've got this virtual concert coming up. Do you think you could take a listen to this song and put together a video for it? And Rob can tell you what his thoughts were on that.
As soon as Ryan played me the song, I was like, this is a great song. Of course, he did also say, can you make a video of this in 2 weeks? And having worked with him for enough years, that was old hat. I was used to that. So that was fine. We're looking at putting together a video during a pandemic. So of course, we can't really film anything. So what we did is we purchased a bunch of stock video clips and I just started cutting them to the song and just listening to the song over and over again and just sort of keying into the message of the song and trying to pair images with that. You needed it in 14 days, so it probably took me 13 days. It was a really fun experience. I hadn't really had much experience in video editing in terms of a music video. I had certainly done product video editing and boring stuff like that. So this is my first attempt at a music video, and it was a lot of fun.
I don't write a lot of songs. Most of my songs come out of something that has inspired me, moved me, spoken to me in some way, shape, or form. As much as I'd love to write, like I said, I have to be inspired and moved. I've got pieces of songs all over my computer that someday might become a project. They might not. But Make a Difference, it all just came together. Once Rob had sent me a rough draft of the video, I had shown it to my wife and we had sent it back to Rob with a couple edits here and there. And then when that was finalized, I reached out to Diane Johnson at Descriptive Video Works and I said, here's the video. Were you willing to take a crack at it? She said, absolutely. So she brought in one of their script writers to write the script to go with Rob's video. And then they went into the studio and recorded the descriptive audio track. And I was just blown away by the end product. It still speaks to me today. And it came together so perfectly that it was just meant to be.
A record spins on a turntable. The needle arm swings over the vinyl, then lowers onto the record's grooves. A globe near the record player rotates. Outside, a boy sits on a brick wall viewing a tablet. In a modest backyard, a toddler wearing a white dress toddles amongst people, drinking and mingling.
I have seen the world through a child's eyes.
The little girl wanders toward the house.
As a place of innocence, wonder and surprise.
An older girl stands before a public fountain.
I can't believe our new reality.
A U.S. soldier holds up a vial labeled COVID-19.
This isn't the way life was meant to be.
Lines on the ground keep people distanced, 6 feet apart.
We can feel the
plays on an outdoor stage.
Or live in a place of hate and poverty.
A woman is passed out in a derelict squat.
We can make a difference if we try.
Volunteers distribute clothing to an elderly couple.
But it has to start with you and I.
Outside, a young mother holds her toddler and waves. Then she straightens his sunglasses. The vinyl record spins on the turntable. A man with tattoos on his neck, who was previously making an angry phone call, is now calm. He wears earbuds and nods his head to the music. A smile tugs at his lips. Another man holds a baby.
I'm grown up now with two kids of my own.
A dad holds up his toddler. A sign reads, Black Lives Matter. Reporters film a Black Lives Matter event.
Will they make the most of their opportunities?
Teachers help children with their schoolwork.
Or make the same mistakes as you and me.
A husband and wife at a computer appear defeated.
We can fill the world with
street, kids play drums. On the beach, a woman dances.
Or live in a place of hate and poverty.
On the ocean's sandy shore, a young girl's dress flutters in the breeze.
We can make a difference if we try.
A boy with dark glasses and a cane is led onto a baseball field.
But it has to start with you and I.
A blonde woman smiles in the hazy sunlight. Teenaged girls embrace with laughter at a food distribution center. A man and a woman hug, their faces beaming. Two men put their arms around each other as they stroll down a street. The husband of the defeated couple now lifts his wife into the air in celebration.
We can fill the world with hope and harmony.
The couple dances in their kitchen with their children.
Or live in a place of hate.
At a community center, Indigenous women dance to drumming.
We can make a difference if we try.
At a social gathering, a woman smiles. A man holds up a baby girl.
But it has to start with you and I.
Friends embrace on a balcony overlooking the night lights of a city.
We can make a difference if we try.
Various people smile in front of a white backdrop.
But it has to start with you and I.
A woman laughs as she smiles. A teenaged girl lowers her eyes bashfully, then reveals a dimply grin. Over distant mountains across a harbor, the sun sets in an orange glow. Credits. Written and performed by Ryan Fleury. Editing by Rob Minot. Electric guitar and piano by Mark Charcello. Descriptive video provided by Descriptive Video Works.
This is Welcome to My World on CKCU FM. I'm Shelley Ann Morris with Rob Minot and Ryan Fleury. We've just heard an audio described song called Make a Difference. Now you've seen a video on radio.
I've received a lot of comments and feedback from people that have had to take a step back when they saw that or heard that video and said, why is this not a thing? We've had music videos since the 80s. And we've talked as well on our podcast on how I'm sure even sighted people are using, well, they are using audiobooks in their cars and audio description on Netflix. You can be in the kitchen cooking and still follow along to your TV show or movie that you're watching. So it works for everybody. And I really hope that going forward, organizations like AMI, Vocali here that does live theater mainly, but they've had to go virtual as well. You know, there's no reason why some of these concerts in these big venues, whether it's Rogers Arena here or whatever it's called now, or the arena in Ontario or wherever you live, that those concerts, they should be described and the outfits the artists are wearing and the scene around the venue. That's all information that I would love to have.
I feel like the folks at Descriptive Video Works had the hardest part of that job because they did their component last. So they had to sort of take that product and develop the script in a way that fit the structure of that song. And that was really all them.
Yeah.
The magical part of it is that you have this participation going on at different levels. You know, you had Ryan that wrote the song, he wrote the lyrics and the music and then passed it off to me. And then I took that and I created this visual component to that. And then the folks at Descriptive Video Works took that and created this new layer of audio description on top of that. And it all worked together in a way that I think if we had planned it out and really tried to do it, I don't think it would have turned out as well.
It's absolutely gorgeous. Rob and Ryan, give us contact information or websites from all the organizations that we've talked about today, and there were quite a few. Rob, we can start with you.
Sure. Anybody who's interested in learning more about Blind Beginnings and the work that we do, you can find us online at www.blindbeginnings.ca. And anyone who's interested in our podcast, it's called AT Banter. You can find us on Spotify or any of your usual podcasting apps, or you can find us online at www.atbanter.com.
Thank you. Ryan, where can we find you?
People can find me and my music at whitecanerecords.com. That's my YouTube channel. And if they want more information on assistive technology, products, software, hardware, support, training, or to sign up to get our emails about the Anti-Gloom Zoom Room or the virtual pub night, they can visit us at www.canastech.com. That's CanassTech.com. Tuesday mornings at 10 a.m. Pacific is our Anti-Gloom Zoom Room, where everybody is welcome on Zoom. And then we have a virtual pub night, which is Thursday evenings from 5 p.m. Pacific until we shut down the room. So that can go all night. It might only be 3-4 hours.
If people are interested in attending either of those, I think, Ryan, they can just go to www.canastech.com and sign up for the mailing list. We email invites out every week.
Hello, this is Roy Forbes. You are listening to CKCU FM. Midnight
is falling. At Canadian Assistive Technologies, we are primarily a blindness and low vision assistive technology company. The braille displays and the screen readers and the CCTVs or the large screen magnifiers or the portable magnifiers. There are a few other odds and ends, like switches for people's physical access needs that we do carry as well. But the gently used section is definitely a place where, you know, if we get something returned or somebody just isn't using a product anymore, Steve will put up on the website and try to rehome it to somebody who can get some benefit from it.
Yeah, and that opens up a whole other can of worms too. And this is something that we've been talking on the podcast lately, is that assistive technology is great, but part of the problem is that we don't really have systems in place, like funding, to get assistive technology to the people that need it. And that's really the problem with assistive technology, is that because it is so specialized and it can be very expensive to produce, somebody who is, say, just entering the job market and doesn't have $5,000 to spend on a braille display, there's just no funding available to get them the device that they need. And that's a real problem. And that's something that I feel like that's sort of the next step of getting funding to the right people to get them the right device, to make companies more inclusive and to allow them to have inclusive hiring practices and able to provide equipment to their employees.
Yeah, it'd be nice if we had a national funding program instead of each province trying to do their own thing. It's so fragmented.
How often have I said, without this Ocutech of mine, the device that I wear on my glasses, I would be virtually blind. I can go in the studio, I just throw my Ocutech on and I can do almost everything a sighted person can do when we're in the studio. Without this device, without my Ocutech, I couldn't function as well at all. Sometimes for us, our devices, well, they're as basic as a pair of shoes. It'd be like telling somebody, go without a pair of shoes. Yeah. Or you can't have light bulbs today. You have to work in the dark. That's as basic as it is.
Yeah.
Makes all the difference.
Yeah. And that's, I think, another gap in the system is there is no one-stop shop to learn about what is available without you either coming into contact with somebody in your same situation. Like, where do you start? When I lost my sight living in the interior of BC, I wasn't aware of BC Blind Sports. I didn't know that I could still ski and snowboard like I did as a sighted person. I didn't know there was tandem cycling, so I could still get out on a bike and ride. Unless you're plugged into a community, you really don't know what's available to you. And I think that's still another missing link.
Yeah, for sure. Education is a real problem. Even amongst people who are blind or partially sighted, a lot of them don't even know the depth and breadth of what's available to them.
Yeah.
Yeah. So definitely education and affordability are definitely things that assistive technology, we really have to sort of bridge that gap. The more mainstream assistive technology can be baked in, the cheaper it can get. Because part of the reason why this equipment is so expensive is that a lot of times they're either add-ons or they are specialized equipment that's only good for assistive technology. But if you look at something like an iPhone, this is something that can be used as a mainstream device, but it's also an incredible piece of AT. And so it's kept affordable because when they manufacture it, they don't have to manufacture it specifically as assistive technology. So I think that that's really where we can see assistive technology become more affordable and to really for that technology to push forward is it being brought into more mainstream devices.
Not to say there isn't still a need for the proprietary devices like Daisy book readers and CCTVs that magnify print 64 times, large print keyboards. There's still going to be a need for those proprietary devices and products. For some of us, the iPhone is all we'll ever need, or an Android phone for that matter with TalkBack is all we'll ever need. But the choices are out there.
I'd like to ask you a favor. Would you mind giving us a station ID, something that we can play on future shows? Introduce yourself. Say that you're listening to Welcome to My World on CKCU 93.1 FM.
We would love to. It would be our honor. Okay, so let me see. Hi, this is Rob Minot, host of the AT Banter podcast, and you're listening to Welcome to My World on CKCU FM.
Thank you. That's great.
Yeah, he has to do it again.
What?
Okay.
What do you mean? Just remember who edits you, Ryan.
That's right.
I can make you say a lot of things.
I have the original.
That's true. Okay, here we go. Hey there, this is Rob Minot, host of the AT Banter podcast, and you're listening to Welcome to My World on CKCU FM.
Wow.
Now do it again.
I'll make Ryan do it several times now.
You would love to.
I will give it a shot.
Sure.
All right. This is Ryan Fleury from whitecanerecords.com, and you've been listening to Welcome to My World on 93.1 CKCUFM.com.
Yay.
Look at that.
Oh, wow. Thanks so much for being on Welcome to My World today.
Thanks for having us. It was an absolute delight.
Absolutely. This is awesome. Thank you so much, Shelley.
Do you have a favorite song?
All I can think of is Margaritaville.
There you go.
Watching the sun bake, all of those tourists covered with oil, strumming my six string on my front porch swing, smell those shrimp there beginning to boil, wasting away. Nothing to show but this brand new tattoo, but it's a real beauty, a Mexican cutie. How it got here, I haven't a clue. Wasting away. My heel had to cry. cruise on back home. But there's booze in the blender, and soon it will render that frozen concoction that helps me hang on. Wasting away again in Margaritaville, searching for my lost shaker of salt. Some people claim that there's a woman to blame, but I know it's my
heart.
Welcome. Of course, the whole world loves Ray Charles. This is nothing new for you. You know, I just realized something the last couple of days. You and I are trying to say about the same thing, but we just say it a little different.
Oh, John, you're just so right. For instance, let's try a little for instance here. Listen to this. I've got down to a last pair of shoes. Can't even win a nickel bet. Listen to this. I ain't got nothing yet.
That's good. Here's my way of saying that. I've got a mess of blues on my mind.
Well.
And at least a million miles behind me. And all that I've got between me and Pauper's Hill is a wrinkle crinkled wadded dollar bill. So we're not much worse. Yeah.
Hey, buddy. And a baby, but I'm busting.
My cotton is down to a quarter a pound, and I'm busting.
I got a count that will cry and a hen that won't lay.
Got a big stack of bills that get bigger each day.
You know,
the county will haul my belongings away. I'm busting. Yeah.
Well, I went to my brother to ask for a loan, cause I was busted.
Yeah. And I hate to beg like a dog for a bone, but I'm busted.
But this is John, what he told me. My brother said there ain't a thing I can do.
My wife and my kids are all down with the flu. And I was just thinking about falling on you.
Cause I'm busting. Oh, John, I need some money. As a matter of fact, I'll beat your last thing.